In 2006, a mysterious methane surge emerged, kicking off a ticking clock that threatens to disrupt our planet's fragile climate balance. Scientists scrambled to identify the source, expecting to find a corresponding increase in fossil fuel emissions. But to their surprise, no such correlation existed. For 16 years, this potent greenhouse gas has been building in strength, defying explanation and sparking widespread alarm. The stakes couldn't be higher. If left unchecked, this methane spike could trigger a catastrophic climate reversal, mirroring the last ice age termination 12,000 years ago. This single event transformed the planet in a matter of decades, rendering entire regions uninhabitable. As the clock ticks, scientists are racing against time to unravel the mystery behind this ominous methane surge. Will they find a solution before it's too late, or will we succumb to the devastating consequences of inaction? Join us as we explore the surprising new evidence that we might have entered an ice age termination event. Our planet has experienced several periods of extensive glaciation, known as ice ages, throughout its long history. The most recent ice age began around 2.6 million years ago and is still ongoing today. This period is marked by the formation and expansion of large ice sheets across the Northern Hemisphere, particularly in North America, Europe, and Asia. During the ice age, global temperatures dropped significantly, causing the expansion of glaciers and ice sheets. These massive bodies of ice can cover vast areas of land and even extend into the oceans. The growth of ice sheets is directly related to changes in the Earth's orbit and tilt, as well as variations in the intensity of the sun's radiation reaching our planet. One of the most notable features of the current ice age is the occurrence of ice age cycles, where periods of intense glaciation called glacial periods are followed by periods of relative warmth called interglacial periods. The last glacial period, known as the last glacial maximum, occurred around 20,000 years ago when ice sheets covered much of North America, Europe, and Asia. During the glacial periods, large portions of the world's land masses were covered in ice, drastically changing the landscape and the distribution of plants and animals. The ice sheets were so massive that they caused a significant lowering of global sea levels, exposing land bridges that allowed the movement of species between continents. As the climate began to warm at the end of the last glacial period, the ice sheets started to melt, leading to a rise in sea levels and the formation of the familiar coastlines we see today. This process of deglaciation has continued, with the ice sheets in Greenland and Antarctica being the remnants of the once extensive glaciation. The effects of the ice ages on the Earth's ecosystems and the evolution of life have been profound. During the ice ages, a lot of big animals like mammoths and saber-toothed cats went extinct. This was partly because of people hunting them, but also because the big changes in the climate made it hard for them to survive. Even though the climate is warmer now, the Earth is still technically in an ice age. It's just an ice age where the glaciers don't cover as much of the planet as they did in the past. These big changes in the climate, where we go from having lots of ice to having less ice, are called ice age termination events. These events can happen in three main stages, but exactly where one stage ends and the next one begins can be a bit tricky to figure out. Before we continue, make sure to hit the subscribe button and click the notification bell to stay updated with our future videos. So let's get straight into it. How does the Earth arrive at an ice age termination event? During a glacial period, massive ice sheets and glaciers across the globe expand to their maximum size, covering vast regions of land and sea. Eventually, something causes that ice to start melting away, marking the end of a glacial period. This process of a glacial period coming to an end is called a termination event, and it typically happens in three distinct phases. The first phase is called the deglacial onset. This slow but steady increase in global temperatures marks the beginning of the end of the glacial period, typically lasting tens of thousands of years. This process is often driven by changes to Earth's orbit, known as Milankovitch cycles. These cycles predominantly relate to variations in the Earth's angle and orbit around the Sun. The first Milankovitch cycle is eccentricity, which describes the shape of the Earth's orbit around the Sun. This can range from a perfect circle, eccentricity of zero, to a more oval or elliptical shape, up to around 0.067. Currently, the Earth's eccentricity is around 0.017, so our orbit is quite circular. However, when the Earth's orbit is more elliptical, the difference in solar energy or insulation received between the closest and farthest points can vary tremendously. This eccentricity cycle has a periodicity of roughly 100,000 years, and past glacial-interglacial transitions have been well aligned with this cycle, occurring approximately 100,000 years apart. Another key Milankovitch cycle is the tilt or obliquity of the Earth's axis. As the Earth rotates around the Sun, its tilt angle oscillates between 22.1 and 24.5 degrees, with a full cycle from minimum to maximum and back taking around 41,000 years. This change in tilt angle also affects the distribution of solar radiation received by the planet, contributing to long-term climate changes. As the Earth's axis tilts further, it exposes a larger polar region to solar radiation during the summer, leading to rapid ice sheet melting and subsequent feedback effects on the global climate. Analysis of the last 800,000 years reveals a strong correlation between these events and the termination of ice ages. Currently, the axial tilt is decreasing from its maximum value, which should, in theory, reduce the melting effects on the ice caps. Another factor is the precession of the Earth's axis, which affects the timing of the seasons relative to the Earth's orbit around the Sun. This cycle operates on a timescale of approximately 19,000 to 23,000 years and shows a regular alignment with termination events. While the correlation is not perfect, it appears that a combination of these factors drives the termination event. These Milankovitch factors create a feedback loop that propagates the warming of the planet. As the ice melts, darker ocean or land surfaces are exposed, which absorb more sunlight and lead to further warming and melting. This process accelerates, driving the Earth into a rapid warming period called full deglaciation. During this phase, significant ice melting and sea level rise occur over a short period, usually decades. The release of greenhouse gases like CO2 and methane, previously dissolved in cold oceans or permafrost, drives further warming, accelerating the process and reorganizing ocean currents. Only after this second rapid heating phase do global temperatures begin to stabilize, marking the onset of an interglacial period, which is the phase we are in now. During this period, ice sheets stabilize and reduce in size, and sea levels come into equilibrium. As temperatures increase, negative feedback loops become more significant, such as the growth of vegetation in previously ice-covered areas, which act as a carbon sink, and weathering processes that draw down atmospheric CO2. These processes serve to stabilize CO2 and temperature levels in the atmosphere, which is the current state of our climate. Why are methane levels rising, and how exactly is it measured? Scientists were shocked to see methane levels go up in 2020, even though the COVID-19 lockdowns led to cleaner air and less carbon dioxide pollution. Methane increased by 15 parts per billion that year, which was the biggest jump they had recorded since 1983. In 2021, the increase was even bigger, 18 parts per billion. Methane is a natural gas that's produced all around us, in wetlands, the oceans, and even in the digestive systems of cows and other animals. It's odorless and colorless, but it's also a powerful greenhouse gas. That means it's really good at trapping heat from the sun. Back in the 1980s, methane levels were soaring as the natural gas industry boomed. But by the 1990s, those levels had stabilized. Then, in the mid-2000s, scientists noticed something strange. Methane was suddenly starting to increase again. What's going on? Well, it turns out it's not always easy to pinpoint the exact sources of methane. Unlike carbon dioxide, which mostly comes from burning fossil fuels, methane has all kinds of natural sources. One thing scientists do know is that methane sticks around in the atmosphere for about a decade before it breaks down. And when it's up there, it's really good at trapping heat, about 80 times better than carbon dioxide. That's because methane's chemical structure is like a perfect heat-absorbing machine, especially in a certain wavelength range that can easily escape out to space. So even though methane doesn't last as long as carbon dioxide, its superheating powers make it a major player in climate change. Methane's molecular structure makes it highly effective at absorbing and emitting infrared radiation, specifically at wavelengths of around 3.5 and 8 microns. This range happens to coincide with an atmospheric window, allowing the radiation to escape into space. In contrast, CO2 absorbs radiation at different wavelengths, which are already effectively absorbed by the atmosphere. This makes methane's contribution to the greenhouse effect more pronounced. In recent years, our ability to detect methane sources has significantly improved, thanks to advanced technologies that can identify emissions from both the ground and space. One particularly interesting approach involves firing a laser at the ground turned to a wavelength of 3.5 or 8 microns. When the laser bounces back, it can be used to create a map of methane levels around the planet. By analyzing the absorbed light, researchers can identify areas of high methane concentration. Using this technology, NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory detected a massive methane plume above an Iranian landfill, emitting over 18,700 pounds of methane per hour. However, this pales in comparison to a cluster of super emitters in Turkmenistan associated with oil and gas infrastructure, which together release over 111,000 pounds of methane per hour. The most recent findings published in Global Biochemical Cycles have shown that methane emissions are increasing in tropical and wetland regions, driven by rising temperatures and CO2 levels. This has led to faster growth and decomposition of organic matter, resulting in higher methane release rates. Permafrost regions, which store vast amounts of carbon, are also contributing to methane emissions as they thaw and release trapped organic material. While modern landfills often have methane capture systems, not all of the methane is captured and some is released into the atmosphere. Fortunately, methane sensing technology is being developed to identify leaks and collect methane emissions from oil and gas infrastructure as well as landfills. This is primarily driven by economic motivations, as capturing and utilizing methane can generate revenue. However, it also has the benefit of reducing greenhouse gas emissions. So what does all this actually mean for us? The data shows that agriculture and waste sources have contributed about half of the recent increase in methane emissions we've seen between 2006 and now. The other half is believed to be driven by natural biogenic processes, especially the wetland feedback loop. Now, the interesting thing is that while the current level of biogenic methane emissions is still within the normal historical range, the speed and acceleration of this trend are extremely high by all historical standards, even during the post-1800s rise driven by fossil fuel use. This component of the methane change is likely something nature hasn't seen before in recent history. The good news is that we're getting better at understanding where exactly all this methane is being emitted from. The challenge is that we don't know what path this trend will follow. And if it's nature itself producing the methane rather than direct human activities, it could be much harder to slow down or interfere with this process. Capturing methane is also really tricky, even more so than capturing CO2 from the air. This is partly because methane is much less abundant in the atmosphere compared to CO2. There are some approaches, like using porous minerals called zeolites, to convert methane to CO2, but these haven't been explored much since producing CO2 isn't very useful right now. However, if it means less potent greenhouse gases are entering the atmosphere, some development in this area could be worthwhile. The bottom line is, we've got a lot of work to do in understanding and addressing this methane challenge. It's a complex issue with a lot of unknowns, but the more we can learn, the better equipped we'll be to tackle it. What do you consider the primary force behind the mass methane emissions? And do you expect this rapid release to continue or slow down over time? We would love to hear your opinion in the comments. If you liked the video, then you should check out the one on your screen. This video on the truth about global warming will blow your mind. Thanks for watching.